Well, good morning and good afternoon to everyone. We're very happy to have you join us on our PEPFAR VMMC Continuous Quality Improvement webinar. My name is Lonnie Martin from the USAID Assist Project managed by URC. And the Assist Project is very pleased to be hosting this webinar, which we've designed to share some of the insights and experiences from introducing continuous quality improvement, or CQI, into voluntary medical male circumcision programs supported by the U.S. government. I'm very pleased. Our agenda over the next 2 hours is going to include, we'll turn things over to Emmanuel Nugemelli from USAID, who is our moderator. And then we're going to have a series of short presentations, first by John Biabagavi from URC. Then we're going to take a little pause and hear some reflections from a stakeholder in Malawi, Mr. Simeon Legenje from the Ministry of Health. And then we'll come back to presentations by Shepherd Mapisa and Sisha Chikanda, both from South Africa. Then we'll take some time for questions and answers, which Dr. Nugemelli will moderate. And what we'd like all attendees to do is to use the chat box on the side of your computer to post questions for any of the presenters or for Emmanuel. And we will take those questions after the third presentation by Cephas Chikanda. Then we're going to switch gears and do a panel with Assist staff to talk about how they have been supporting ministries and implementing partners in Uganda, South Africa, Malawi, and Tanzania to introduce CQI. And then we're going to end up with a panel of stakeholders from U.S. government and implementing partners to get their reflections on how this process has worked. So I'd like to now turn things over to Dr. Nugemelli, our moderator. Emmanuel, welcome.
Thank you very much, Lani. I am pleased to welcome all of you to this PEPFAR-sponsored VMMC webinar, the first of important VMMC webinars this week. Today we will hear from colleagues from Uganda, South Africa, Malawi, and Tanzania on the progress that has been made to date in out continuous quality improvement in VMMC programs in four countries. The webinar scheduled on Thursday, also at 8 a.m. U.S. Eastern Time, will be hosted by John Hopkins Center for Communication Programs and will address making VMMC programs sustainable. Regarding continuous quality improvement, I have been a vocal supporter of continuous quality improvement in our VMMC programming because I have seen with my own eyes the difference that the CQI can make to the sites that have been found in EQA to have even serious deficiencies. We started introducing CQI activities in 2012, and I have to say that we have seen really convincing results, especially when we compare EQA results for sites that have undergone CQI with those that haven't. For PEPFAR VMMC program, we no longer see a CQI component as optional. Rather, we are convinced that all VMMC programs must build in CQI into their planning and budgets. We cannot afford to slow down the gains that have been made to date due to problems with quality of care and patient safety. As you will hear today, there is not sufficient experience from the field on how CQI can be introduced and scaled up through a program. I have asked the ASSIST project to share their experience and tools with all the implementing partners, and we will make sure that all programs have access to CQI training as part of VMMC training. I would like now to begin with the presentations part of our webinar. I'm very happy to have these presenters share with us how they have introduced CQI into VMMC programs. We will begin with John Biabagambi from the ASSIST project in Uganda, who will give us a short presentation to what the CQI process looks like and what have been results in Uganda, South Africa, Malawi, and Tanzania. Following John's presentation will be one from Shepard Mafisa, from Dr. Mafisa and partners in Johannesburg, to share what the private provider's experience with CQI in VMMC has been. He will be followed by Stefas Shikanda from ANOVA, who will share the lessons his organization had found applying CQI in VMMC sites in Mpumalanga province in South Africa. We will take questions after all three speakers have finished their presentations. Please use the chat function to pose your question and indicate which speaker the question is for. You can also email your question to sdeka@ghu.edu. Sid from the ASIS team will be collecting those questions, and we will then be able to manage them during the question and answer session. Now, our first presentation from John Biabagambi of ASIS. John, please go ahead.
John, can you hear us? John, we're ready for you to begin. I think you might try unmuting yourself because we can't hear you.
John, can you hear us?
John, we're not.
We can't hear you.
John, we're still not hearing you on audio.
Hello?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Yes, now we can hear you, John. Can you please go ahead?
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much. My name is John Biabagambi, and I work with the ASIS project. I'll be sharing with you an overview of the VMMC CQI process and some of the results we have in the four ASIS-supported countries. To get started, let me briefly explain one of the frameworks we use in our quality improvement approach. Quality improvement integrates both content and process of care. Commonly, we find that health units have protocols, standards, and guidelines, what we call traditional quality improvement. Having these is not enough. I once visited a health unit where a service provider was standing next to the guidelines for mixing the chlorine solution. When I asked them to tell me about the process of preparing a 0.5% solution, they couldn't explain anything. So we have to look at how the processes are conducted. You could have the best operating theater, but if your clients are not properly health educated, reviewed after surgery, the service quality remains poor. Therefore, our QI approach is in two broad categories. We look at the content of care, what we are calling the VMMC standards, and the processes of care. And this framework shows these two broad categories. A good number of us have heard about the VMMC external quality assessment. Quality assurance and quality improvement are complementary in improving the quality of VMMC program. Whereas the EQA, as an example of quality assurance, is generally associated with the monitoring of compliance with standards, CQI supports teams to make changes to address gaps, some of which are identified through the EQA. Commonly, we find that providers know the level of the expected service, but their biggest challenge is how to consistently deliver at that expected level at all the times for each and every client that goes through their clinic. So using the CQI approach, we support service providers to make changes and continuously monitor themselves through data to meet the expected level of quality. So how do we apply the CQI approach in the program? We use this model for improvement that is based on three questions. First, teams need to have a clear understanding of what they are trying to accomplish. For example, they could say we are trying to improve post-operative review of clients. And secondly, the teams need to have an objective way of measuring improvement to enable them to make decisions on whether to keep, drop, or modify some of the changes they make to improve their processes of care. And thirdly, what changes they need to know what changes to make that will help them improve their processes. So after they've identified what changes they could test, they need to take them through the PDSA process, where they plan how they are going to test the change, who is going to be involved, when, what resources are required. Then they go to the next step, which is do, which means actually testing the change. They make the changes to their process of care and study where they collect objective data to understand whether the changes are giving them the desired results or they need to make modifications. So with that, with the data, they are able to make a decision, which is under the acting phase, where they have to make a decision to either maintain the changes or modify them or abandon them. So we support teams to do rapid testing of changes to improve care at the points of service delivery and make ongoing measurements to assess performance. And this process is led by site staff, often with coaching support from Ministry of Health and implementing partners. And the whole process addresses all points of VMMC continuum of care to ensure that quality care that is effective, responsive, and respectful is offered to the clients. So the teams need to view their clinics as a system. And drawing on the on this quotation from Batalden, every system is perfectly designed to get the results that it gets. It means that for clinics that get very many adverse events, it means they are designed in a such way that they get many adverse events. For clinics where only 20% of clients come back for follow-up after circumcision, it means the service providers have set up their clinics in a such a way that only 20% of clients will come back for review. So to achieve different results, we have to make changes to improve our processes of care. We need to understand the process of educating clients. So we need to understand our work in terms of processes and systems. For example, the process of obtaining informed consent. What does it mean? Who should be involved? What resources are required? Then if we identify any gaps through the process of understanding our work, we have to develop solutions to address any gaps that we identify. And then we have to keep our minds on the needs of the client. Clients need safety, they need a timely service, they need an efficient service, and they need an effective service. We also need to collect objective data to assess the impact of the changes. And finally, we need to share best practices so that we can improve the entire program and not just in a few selected sites. So what steps do we follow in implementing our CQI approach? Often we start with a stakeholder engagement where we identify who are the important stakeholders in this process. We select sites together with the stakeholders and identify coaches. Then we go through a process of local adaptation of tools and training for assessors to ensure that the tools that we are going to be using are in agreement with other existing national tools and guidelines. Then we conduct a baseline assessment to know the starting level of performance. Thereafter, we support teams to form quality improvement teams that will spearhead the entire process. Then we conduct a CQI training for teams that may not be familiar in using the CQI approach. And we also use that same training to have a deeper analysis of our baseline findings so that we have a common understanding of what we are trying to achieve. Then we support sites to test changes to improve their quality and monitor indicators to evaluate the effects of the changes that are being tested. We regularly reassess sites, commonly on a quarterly basis, and in between we conduct CQI on-site coaching and sharing of learning across sites. So this slide shows our progress in the four countries. All the four countries have completed the process of stakeholder engagement and tools adaptation. Baseline assessment has been completed in Uganda, South Africa, and Malawi. It is still ongoing in Tanzania. And then teams in Uganda, South Africa, and Malawi are receiving on-site support in form of coaching and training to address the gaps. Uganda and South Africa have gone ahead to conduct peer-to-peer learning sessions. So far, what results have we achieved? This slide shows a dashboard. Whenever we conduct an assessment, we summarize our findings using a dashboard, which is based on three main colors. Green signifies good performance, yellow signifies fair performance, and red signifies poor performance. White shows a site where an assessment was not conducted. So from this dashboard, we see that when the baseline assessment was conducted in Uganda, way back in February to March 2013, most sites were in red for most of the standards, especially management systems and monitoring and evaluation. So through the support that I've already mentioned, on-site coaching, CQI training, peer-to-peer learning sessions, the teams have gradually addressed most of the standards. And as we can see from these three dashboards, we've eliminated red. We don't have any standard which is still scored as poor. We still have a few areas that are scored as fair, but generally what we see is that there has been gradual improvement from red to more green. So like I said, our work is divided into two broad categories, the standards and the processes of care. So as an example of the processes of care, obtaining informed consent is vital. When we conducted a baseline assessment in January, between January and May 2013, there was no evidence of consent for each and every client, either because it was not obtained or it was obtained but not documented. So there was no evidence to show that indeed clients were providing consent. So teams were supported to test changes to address this gap. First, we started by sharing with the service providers the importance of consent, addressing the problem of lack of consent forms, streamlining the process of obtaining informed consent. What does it mean? When should it be obtained? From who and by who? And since then, for close to 2 years, this problem has been addressed at the first 30 sites. When we scaled up our support to 19 additional sites, we were surprised to find that it was still a problem as of June 2014 in the new sites that we had taken on, 6 months after it had been addressed after the first 30 sites. So currently we are putting most of our efforts on spreading learning from the first pilot sites to all the VMMC sites so that for gaps where we know the solutions, we can be able to share them with all the sites. Another example is the process of reviewing clients after circumcision within 48 hours. So what we see is that at baseline, less than 30% of the clients would be reviewed. And once again, we address this by first discussing with the service providers the importance of this visit. And thereafter, the teams themselves tested several changes to improve the follow-up at this visit. And one of the changes tested was to give a clear message regarding follow-up, as opposed to giving mixed messages. Initially, this information was only given by the postoperative nurse, but today it starts from group education. It is also given during the surgical procedure and also at postoperative care. So at all these points, the message is clear, consistent, and the clients are told you need to come back on such and such a specific date, not just telling the client come back after 48 hours, because some clients will get confused. They want to know when do the 48 hours begin, when do they end. So you have to be specific and tell the client come back on this date, and you write it down. And what we see is that from this graph, we note that the first 30 sites took about 1 year to reach performance of 80%. But in the new sites, it has taken us a slightly shorter period because of the shared learning that I've been talking about. So in South Africa, we support 124 sites that are located in 9 provinces, supported through 3 PEPFAR agencies. And as we see from their baseline dashboard, which was of June to October 2014, the major gaps were in leadership and planning, the surgical procedure, and infection prevention. So between the baseline assessment of June and February 2015, the sites received on-site support in the form of QIT information, on-site coaching, and as we see from the dashboard, they've also managed to reduce the number of standards that are scored in red, and we have more green, more standards that are scored in green. This slide shows what I've just been talking about, which is a comparison of the baseline assessment findings and the first reassessment, which was done 3 to 6 months later. And what we see is that all the 8 standards, there has been an improvement when we compare the assessment after 3 to 6 months with the baseline findings, showing how CQI is indeed useful in addressing the gaps that we find in our program. The next slide shows our results from Malawi. In Malawi, we support 3 implementing partners, located in 7 districts. We conducted the baseline assessment at 13 sites in April 2015. And once again, what we see from the baseline assessment is that management system is the most challenging problem, like we saw in Uganda. And the other areas that are challenged, the teams are supplies, M&E, and individual counseling sessions for HIV and HIV counseling and testing. So after the assessment, we conducted a QI training, which was attended by the VMMC coordinators, the zonal health office officer for quality assurance, implementing partner staff, and the national program officer for VMMC. Teams have been supported to form, the health units have been supported to form quality improvement teams, and on-site coaching and mentorship have been initiated and are ongoing. We plan to conduct the first reassessment in September this year to see if there's progress indeed being made by the team. In Tanzania, which is our newest country for our VMMC CQI technical support, we've started the baseline assessment. So far, 6 sites have been assessed, and what we've found is that the service is vertical in operation. Sites lack VMC work plans and client flowcharts. Many sites lack emergency equipment like oxygen cylinders and timers. And sites will need support in areas of counseling, infection prevention, and use of data to make decisions. We also see that sites will need support in terms of space, because there's lack of space for offering the required services at some of the sites. So why is it important to integrate CQI in the program? One, CQI empowers frontline health workers to assume control over the quality and outcomes, encourages innovation and accountability, and also promotes ownership. CQI complements the EQA to address areas of deficient performance. Through the EQ, we identify gaps and we use CQI to address the gaps. It is critical to good programmatic and clinical outcomes because it helps us to ensure patient safety, improve infection prevention, and reduce adverse events. And it is also critical to demand creation and improvement in efficiency, and it helps us to be efficient in our service delivery. So based on our experience in Uganda, we've written a manuscript which is based on our findings from the 30 pilot sites. It has been accepted for publication. And going forward, we shall be sharing more of our work so that we can promote this shared learning. Also, along the way, we've developed several tools and guidance products. We have a guide for improving the quality of safe male circumcision. We have developed dashboards, databases that help sites to track improvement. We have also developed several case studies that are available online for other teams to learn from. Finally, I would like to appreciate the contributions of the ministries of health in the four countries, the implementing partners, the site teams, and the USG staff to these results. This work is made possible by the support of the American people through the ASSIS project that is managed by the University Research Company. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. And I appreciate how you have explained what CQI is and how it can benefit VMMC program in every country. Before we move to the next two additional presentations, I will actually use John's acknowledgement to Ministry of Health, very important leadership in this work, to welcome Donna, who is going to ask two questions to Dr. Simeon Lijenje from the Malawi Ministry of Health, who is going to share his perspective on how the Ministry of Health leadership have helped us to be able to achieve these results John just shared. Simeon have an urgent commitment, and he cannot stay until the end of this webinar. That's the reason why we are moving his intervention before the next two questions. Donna, please go ahead.
Thank you, Manuel. Good morning and good afternoon to everybody. It is my pleasure to introduce Mr. Simeon Lijenje, who is the National VMMC Coordinator in the Ministry of Health in Malawi. Simeon, can you hear us? Hello, Simeon?
Simeon, we're not getting you.
Simeon, can you hear us?
We have you logged in as Martin Matika at USAID in Malawi. Tewange, with Simeon, if you have a number that we can reach you at, we'll try to bring you in that way. If you could send it to Anita instead.
Okay, while we are trying to fix the audio connection between us and Malawi, let's move to the next presentation from Dr. Shepard Mafisa from South Africa.
Shepard, we've made you the presenter. Can you please continue? Bear with us for just a second. We're trying to get Shepard online so he can begin his presentation. And in the meantime, thank you for your chat questions. We are gathering those, and when we get to the question and answer session, we will be taking those.
Welcome to WebEx.
There we are. Given, can you hear us?
Hello.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Shepard,
good morning and good afternoon, everybody.
Yes, please go ahead. You can use the presenter. Move your slides.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much. Good afternoon and good morning to everybody. I'm Dr. Mapisa. I'm the managing partner for Dr. Mapisa and Partners in Johannesburg. We run a medical center in Johannesburg in the CBD, Lisa Medical Center. We have run it since 2002. We are basically a primary care facility. We offer GP services as primary care services. That includes consultations, wellness, family planning, antenatal, men's clinic, minor surgical procedures, dentists, dispensing, travel clinic, and laboratory services. We started getting involved with VMMC in November 2012, supported by CHEPS and USAID. Initially, CHEPS trained six of our nursing staff, two doctors, including myself, and two clinical associates. Clinical associates are some countries that are called clinical officers. In North America, they're called physician assistants. Our catchment area typically includes the Greater Johannesburg area, the CBD, and also the surrounding townships, Tembisa, Kosoras, the East Rand, West Rand, Soweto, and Soshangure. The reason our catchment area is so large is because Lista Clinic itself, the building itself, has been a medical center since 1970, so it's quite popular in Johannesburg. The baseline assessment that was used by URFC to assess us consisted of a medical doctor, professional nurses, and the monitoring and evaluation personnel. Non-clinical staff assessed non-clinical areas which they were knowledgeable about. That is monitoring and evaluation, registration, group education, IEC, and non-surgical commodities. The doctor and professional nurses, can you hear me? The doctor and professional nurses assess clinical areas, including male surgical procedure, surgical equipment, and infection control. The assessment is explained to all of us in the site team. And as shown in the dashboard, the baseline assessment results for August 2014 are as follows according to the quality standard. Number one, leadership and planning, we scored badly. there was a big gap, a big valley. Management systems also scored quite badly. Monitoring and evaluation was quite bad. Registration, group counseling, IEC materials, we did very well. Individual counseling for MMC procedure and HIV testing, we also did quite well. Infrastructure, supplies, equipment, and environment, we did well. The male surgical procedure itself, we fared fairly well, but not that well. Infection prevention and control, we didn't do well. And our overall performance was 6.7%, which was not too well for a facility that has been in operation since 2012. The URFC team set about getting us to close the gaps that they found in the baseline assessment. There was an in-depth baseline assessment feedback on performance that involved several meetings. We were supported to form a QI team. Roles and responsibilities were outlined. There was on-site orientation of the team on how to identify gaps and how to address them. The team was supported to develop specific aims and actions, allocate responsibilities to specific members, and time frames to complete each task and to review if desired outcomes was met. This made quite a big difference, actually. Subsequent coaching sessions were conducted. Some changes were tested and implemented. The site manager obtained the catchment area map that initially was not available. This site area map shows the male population size in our catchment area. The 11-12 VMMC guidelines and policies were made available for everybody. The flow chart drafted by the team leader and was displayed on the facility. The facility started to collect data on adverse events, which we didn't do before, and analyzing it and taking action to prevent further occurrence. That specific MMC plan was drafted by the site manager and implemented. We established a working relationship with the nearest Department of Health Community Health Center, that is Hillbrook Clinic, and Dr. Madonsela, who runs Hillbrook Clinic, was very helpful. SCT kits, SCT register, are now provided to our clinic by the Department of Health, and we share our statistics with them. Cleaners and staff received in-service training on infection prevention and control by the site manager. This made a very big difference because infection control was one of our major problems. Staff were made aware of the content of the infection prevention and control policy measures, and cleaners were provided with utility gloves. When you compare our initial dashboard to our dashboard assessment in April 2015, there was a very big difference. Yes, you will note that on the right, everything is green, and particularly with the leadership and planning, we improved from 12.5 to 80%. We have just received a note from UCR that they will be coming, and one would want to know what the dashboard would look like when you compare the three dashboards. Lessons learned from this exercise: no organization can monitor themselves or self-regulate anywhere in the world. It can be done, especially where profit is a motivation. You cannot manage what you cannot measure. Data is therefore vital to measure one's performance, hence the need for an external and objective CQI who is not part of the organization that is being assessed. In the picture, you can see our QI, our internal QI team. There are about 7 of them. They comprise right from a professional nurse to the cleaners and even a driver. And they feel extremely motivated about the fact that they are making a difference. They are responsible for the quality of the work that is coming out of the clinic. As the head of the clinic, I sit as an alternate. The reason is so that we empower them. If I were to sit in there on a daily basis, it would be unfair. I would like to acknowledge first and foremost our clients. I suppose as a private organization, they provide us with the business. I also would like to thank the Department of Health in South Africa. I would like to thank CHEPS, USAID Assist, USAID South Africa, and PEPFAR for a great job well done. Thank you.
Thank you, Shepard. The Lister Medical Center example is a very important one to show how private sector providers can use and benefit from CQI. Let's try one more time to have Malawi on the line for Simeon to give his perspective before he can leave us for his commitment. Donna, please go ahead. Do we have Malawi, are you on the line?
Martin Matika, it looks like you're logged on as a presenter, and if you can unmute yourself, you should be able to speak. Simeon, I'm sorry we're not being able to reach you. Martin Matika at the USAID Malawi, are you able to use your audio? We are not hearing you.
Okay, while we are sorting out the technical issues with Malawi, let's move to the next presentation. Now I would like to invite Dr. Shepard to stand up and over here, Institute, to share the experience. Shepard, please go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Emmanuel, can you hear me?
Hear you well, thank you.
We can hear you very well, Stefan.
Right, so my name is...
Can you unmute yourself, Stefan?
Okay.
Yes, now we can hear you. Please go ahead.
Okay. So I'm going to take you through our experiences in CQI at ANOVA Health Institution. I've titled my presentation, All Hands on the Deck, just to highlight that CQI is a process that needs everyone to be involved. So just a brief background in terms of the setting. The four sites that we're referring to. In Etlanzeni district, in a sub-district called Bushbuck Ridge, we are operating there in three hospitals and two community health centers supported by 38 primary health care facilities. The main site has been operational since 2010, and to date we've done about 52,000 procedures. But the number of sites grew from one, and in 2014 we expanded this to about four sites. So the presentation hinges on the CQI process that was done between August of 2014 for the baseline assessment. The follow-up assessment was then done in April and May of 2015. Just in terms of the major gaps that were identified in the initial CQI, primarily there were gaps identified in terms of our demand creation activities, by them being limited to schools and local clinics. There was a big gap in terms of programs leadership and stewardship. Weak community linkages in the way in which the facilities that we are operating and how they link to communities. We didn't do any of the client relationship management like satisfaction surveys. We had challenges with poor infrastructure that includes inadequate lighting in some of the facilities. And not all facilities had enough essential equipment. In terms of the pre-surgical processes, we did identify some gaps in age-specific VMMC counseling and testing. And part of the history taking during the surgical process had also some gaps. And then in general, in terms of the post-surgery, we also had gaps in terms of our infection control procedures and waste management, and some challenges with monitoring and evaluation. So we then decided, how are we going to tackle the challenges that have been identified? And the first step we needed to do was we needed to build consensus that we had problems and we needed to tackle them as a collective, hence why I titled my topic, All Hands on the Deck. So we then decided that we needed to bring everyone on board, and one of the things we did was to have a two-day retreat where we brought in staff from the assist team that had done the baseline assessment, teams from both the district and provincial authority, our internal ANOVA teams, including those from head office and those on the site, facility managers from the district and contracted GPs that work with us in the district, and our demand creation partner. Part of the reason why we thought of doing a retreat was that we kind of needed to create a safe space to manage the psychology of resistance and emotions around CQI, because, you know, when gaps are identified, not everyone takes them in a light manner. So we really needed to unpack the findings of the baseline assessment and sort of close the gap between the intention and the interpretation. And then validate some of these findings. In some instances, we found that some findings were adverse, but one needed also to kind of unpack the contextual issues. And in the process, we needed to design a communication plan and have specific action plans and next steps, and in the process, assign some roles and accountabilities to the people involved. So then the next was then to then go on to the intervention process. And one of the things we then did was to appoint an internal CQI coordinator. And on the assist team, we were assigned to a dedicated CQI person who was going to focus on our district. And the two worked together to formulate a CQI intervention team that focused on all the four sites. And jointly, in line with the findings of what we did in our retreat, they developed an intervention action plan. They then held regular monthly meetings, which were followed by training and mentorship on CQI. So after about 8 months, we realized some gains. And some of the few things that
Martin, can you speak to your speaker?
Yeah, we just remove your voice.
Martin, can you please speak to yourself, Martin?
I'm going to increase the volume on this one, maybe. Then we can.
Alavi, please, can you mute yourself? Stefan, please go ahead.
Okay, fine. Yes.
Can I try to speak and see if we can do
it? Stefan, please go ahead.
Okay. So,
can you please go ahead?
No,
Cephas, please go ahead.
Yes, so that is now we can speak here. Yeah. It takes them that we cannot speak.
But you speak easily for me?
No.
Yes. Over there. So I need to move the
headphone. Okay, because I'm already. I see.
Shiwange, this is Lonnie.
Yes.
You only mute yourself right now because we're still in Cephas's presentation. Okay? Thank you. Cephas, please go ahead.
All right. I'll continue from slide number 6. And I was saying that some of the observations that worked according to us is that the aspect of leadership and stewardship, just by involving the right people in the retreat and in the feedback, we managed to galvanize influence and energy around the CQI. And in the process, we managed to build trust between the Department of Health and the implementing partner. And then just having the different delegations ensured that the whole value chain was represented, so everyone kind of knew that they had a role to play. And in the process, we kind of like enabled the building of complementary expertise, authority, and credibility. And that in itself then fostered cooperation from all stakeholders, and in reference to the hospital management teams, the district management, and the provincial management, because prior to that, MMC was being treated as a vertical program whose sole responsibility was that of the implementing partner being ANOVA. We also noticed that setting the common goals actually enabled the whole process to be much easier going forward, because from the retreat, we emerged with a common vision and with clear definition of roles and responsibility. We also outlined our long-term, including our short and medium-term objectives. And in the process, we did a prioritization process to say, where do we start? And we agreed upon an action plan. In terms of the other additions, we also realized that there were gaps in terms of procurement. So we did some supportive procurement, which included infrastructure expansion and then procurement of essential equipment. And lastly, one of the things that also worked was the enhanced communication and people management. We kind of created a space for people to disagree and to disagree on certain issues that they felt were not a priority. But in the process, in ensuring that all voices were heard, we fostered cooperation. And we moved towards erring on the side of over-communication. So that, followed by the regular meetings, also ensured that there was momentum in terms of implementing the CQI. The other thing that we did was also to ensure that there is co-branding, which is in line with the National Department of Health Social Mobilization Strategy. Instead of branding our own vehicles with our own approaches ANOVA, we decided to adapt the national strategy. So when it came to branding, what people saw on TV or heard on radio and then saw in our clinics was consistent, and that sort of like fostered a consistent message, and we think it paid dividends in terms of social mobilization. So if you can see from the time when the baseline was done in August 2014 to April, May 2015, there were marked improvement. I think from the dashboard you can see that most of the reds were replaced by green. One of the quick wins that we observed was the leadership and planning aspect, because the management attended our meetings and they really committed to certain things. In only one area where you look where there's still a red, one of the reasons why that did happen was because during the process of the CQI, there was change in leadership and management at the facility. So as a result, that's one area that kind of suffered. But in terms of all the other areas, there were marked improvements in terms of the CQI process. So in summary, what can we see were some of the lessons learned? We actually picked up that CQI has the potential to make a difference because it had some overarching benefits that went beyond our VMMC program. So the whole CQI then fostered quality improvement across the whole hospital in other program areas. And then just that the cooperation from all stakeholders unlocks potential. And then in the process also it enables the sharing of resources and efforts, and that makes a massive difference. And just by itself, I think Dr. Mapisa highlighted it, that you cannot, you know, assess yourself, but CQI for us enabled us to create a platform for regular introspection, and that in its own also led to some improvements. And I'll also say that there's no substitute for leadership buy-in. You kind of need to get everyone across the value chain to buy into the CQI for it to work. And also that some structural interventions are very critical, although they are not enough by themselves, but the tangibility of some structural support makes the CQI process more manageable. So this has been just one assessment. So in terms of some of our concerns and fears going forward is, how sustainable is this, given the increased staff attrition, and just the worry from my standpoint that are the teams not going to get weary of CQI? How do we, you know, maintain that momentum to continue with CQI? And then some of the system challenges, like I've already highlighted, the change in leadership, particularly on part of the DOH. So how then do you harness their cooperation and buy-in when there are these regular changes at district level? And then some of the consideration we picked just from feedback from the team, that maybe there needs to be some kind of formalized master trainers for CQI, and this could be done during the seasonal law periods so that people get on board with CQI. And then some of the challenges were some problem-solving techniques that this could also add on to the CQI process if that could be provided. And possibly some platform for exchange, because when people work in isolation, they think they're the only ones just doing something. So if there is some form of exchange that enables people to realize that they can also learn from each other. And I think one of the gaps that we observed just from feedback was the lack of visual aid materials then to aid that CQI process. Just in terms of acknowledgements, I'd like to thank my team that was involved in the CQI, Dr. Mlimo and Mr. Dlamini, who led our team. Also to acknowledge the assist team that participated in the whole CQI process, the Mpumalanga Provincial Department, particularly Mr. Ngomane, and just to acknowledge funding that we got through Right to Care, that's through USAID, and Right to Care through the USAID Emergence Fund. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephen. ANOVA's partnership with the South Africa Provincial Department of Health in Mpumalanga is the best practice, and your insight about what has really helped to achieve your excellent result can really help other programs. I just want to add that one important information CEFAS have not shared is actually how the program in Mpumalanga, it does have significantly improved even in terms of number of circumcision performed on daily basis, which again demonstrate that while we can be able to improve and make sure that we provide quality of services, this is also the best way for us to even improve site utilization and make sure that the capacity of those sites are fully utilized to decrease the unit cost of circumcision. Now we have some time for questions for our presenters. And first, let's try again to have Simeon from Malawi Ministry of Health. Donna, can you please go ahead with two questions for Simeon before we take questions that we receive from our audience through the chat?
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. Simeon, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Welcome. Thank you for joining us. Simeon, I have introduced you before, and I am pleased to say that you are coordinating the VMMC program from the Ministry of Health in Malawi. My first question to you would be to tell us a little bit about how the leadership in Malawi from the Ministry of Health has contributed towards making CQI in the circumcision program a reality.
Thank you very much, Donna. In the first place, let me thank you and the entire panelists. First of all, when the assist came to our department, which is the HIV department, where VMMC is housed, we first introduced the assist to the department in the Ministry of Health, where it looks after quality assurance. So we booked an appointment, myself, Tonge, and the B from USAID, and we went to the ministry for the buying of the assist consent, and it was well received. And then we went ahead to introduce the assist to the TWG, that's the Technical Working Group, that's the VMMC Technical Working Group. And then we had the assist made its presentation to the Technical Working Group, and the Technical Working Group had no problems with the assist. I think they felt that it's really important and it came out at the right time. And the USAID called all implementing partners and briefed them on the coming in of assist in making sure that they implement the MMC according to the RED standards.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Simeon. My second question to you is, now that you have described the role of assist within the technical working group within the Ministry of Health, what would be your advice to other ministries of health around the world who would like to incorporate CQI in their MMC programs?
Yeah, my thinking on this question is that let me also mention here that the external quality assurance which was done before the assist baseline revealed a lot of challenges in terms of quality assurance, and this fueled the ministry to indeed welcome the assist in implementing, making sure that the partners implementing the VMMC according to the RED standards. And what I would suggest to other ministries in other countries which are also implementing VMMC is that the most important thing is to get the deadline assessment completed, because this is where you are going to identify the gaps in terms of how the service is being delivered.
Simeon, thank you so much. I really appreciate all of your comments, and I'm so sorry that you cannot be with us, but certainly we will take into account all of your comments going forward. Thank you very much. Let me hand over to Emmanuel once again.
Thank you very much, Simeon and Donna. Now let's take some questions from the audience to our presenters. There is a question from Tik Mangono that is related to the sustainability of CQI. This is exactly what the question is. Is CQI intervention structured to be sustainable? For example, are we identifying the sites that need different levels of CQI intervention, red, yellow, green, working with them to get to some sort of CQI ceiling, and then scale down the intervention to light, touch afterwards? And the second part of the question, in a resource-limited setting, it may not be possible to keep on monitoring sites 4 times a year due to human resource and funding constraints, especially if this CQI is being done on top of EQA and EQI. Please comment on sustainability and cost impact of the CQI exercise. I will invite John to take on the first question. The questions related to sustainability, I think that CEFAS have touched a little bit on the sustainability aspect on his presentation. And what I would like to do is to invite John to also make a quick comment on sustainability. And after that, Dr. Mafisa will actually tell us him as a private provider, if now the PEPFAS support to his clinic stop, is it possible for his clinic to be able to sustain building from what he will have learned from this particular activity? John, can you please go ahead?
Thank you, Emmanuel, and thanks for the question. Regarding to sustainability, yes, we put that into consideration, and right from the beginning, all the activities that we do are joint activities. We've trained the site teams to administer the assessment to themselves so that they don't have to wait for an external assessor to come and tell them how they are performing. So they know how to use the tools, and they can always administer them at any time. But we've also gone ahead to train the district best coaches so that they can act as external assessors to the site. Since these are already employed by the government, they can always go back to the site and provide this CQI support, both the assessment and also supporting the teams to test changes to address any gaps that are identified. Also, we support the teams to integrate the services into other routine activities at the health unit. We support the teams to order supplies through the national medical stores. We support the teams to be able to quantify what supplies they need, the stocks, the amounts, so that all these are integrated into the routine activities at the health unit, so that when this CQI support ends, the teams and the districts and the ministries of health are in position to move the entire approach forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, John. Dr. Mafisa, please, can you please share with us your perspective related to the sustainability of this approach?
Thank you, Emmanuel. From a private practice point of view, we have no choice but to sustain it. Private practice is a minefield. Without quality in the work that we do, sooner or later, you find yourself in court. The way to go about it is firstly to train and retrain the team that was trained by URC, the internal CQI team. To train it, retrain it, and strengthen it. The next thing which we have already done is to transfer the processes at the VMMC on at our site to the rest of the practice. And you are a family practice, our VMMC patients probably constitute only 10% of the patients that we see on a daily basis. So what we are doing at VMMC in terms of CQI, could also do in terms of the rest of our patients, that's exactly what we started doing. And finally, CQI has become a culture within the practice. It is slowly becoming a culture, and that's the only way to sustain it. And once again, as a private provider, it's motivated by profit. You don't want to find yourself in court. But also, you want to produce good work. You want to be proud of the work that you do, and
just get very proud and satisfied when they know what they're doing. They're well trained. They know what's expected of them. And we've not just got to sustain it, and we will sustain it. I hope that answers the question broadly.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shepard. I think the aspect of sustainability deserves several perspectives here. What we will do is that we will try to put together additional perspective and to address all of these questions, and all of this will be posted with the recording of this webinar. I would like to condense several questions that came from several of the participants related to the color coding and the standards related to leadership and management. I think this question was directed to John from several of the participants who want to know why is it that leadership and management was a grade so low, and what really goes into the standard of leadership and management. So John, can you please address these questions?
Okay, thank you once again. Leadership and planning looks at a higher level stewardship, whereas the management systems looks at site level stewardship. Under leadership and planning, for example, we look at the catchment population, if the site or the district is aware of their catchment population, whether they have a catchment map showing the population size, whether they know the male population estimate of their catchment area, and also whether the provincial or the district work plans incorporate the VMMC service delivery, and also if there's any evidence of supervisory visits or coaching visits from the district to the site. So that is what we basically have under leadership and planning. Whereas under management systems, we look at whether the organization of the service at a clinic level. For example, is there a client flow chart to show what processes are involved in the service? Do they have, for example, the necessary reference materials, guidelines, and protocols to make reference to if they have a problem, if they're stuck? Do they have the right resources, both the human resource trained staff, the right cadres? Do they have the right supplies? Do they have a functional quality improvement team? Do they conduct client satisfaction surveys to know what is happening? So basically, that is the difference between leadership and management. And why it was scored low, why leadership and planning was scored low, is because this is something that had been ignored, because it looks at the way the service is organized at a higher level in a district or in a province, to see whether you have that high level planning to ensure that you're going to be on course to achieve the target. So most of the sites were not thinking beyond what happens at site level. It was only concentrating on how many clients are we circumcising, but we don't know, without knowing how many more are out there that need to be circumcised. So briefly, that is what I can say about the two.
Thank you very much, John. I also want to add that there are some questions related to more detail on the categories included in all of those standards. The CQI tool is posted on ASIS website, and I think that we will also provide a link that will provide you a very good understanding of all the various standards that are assessed and look at when we conduct CQI intervention in those sites. There is one question directed to Dr. Mafisa. So the question is, what motivated you as a leader, manager, to work towards performance improvement? I will actually direct this question to both Mafisa and Cephas.
Dr. Mafisa as the owner of a private clinic and Steadfast as the manager of an NGO receiving funding to implement VMMC program in the province. Dr. Mafisa, can you please start by sharing with us in 1 minute what was your personal motivation to work toward performance improvement in your clinic?
First and foremost, the major motivation is to avoid adverse events. Private practice is a minefield. Secondly, it's satisfying to produce quality work from your practice. It's a reward. Quality work is rewarding. In a nutshell, that's it.
Yeah, I think from the ANOVA side, the motivation was, I think, twofold. Number one was that we saw it as an opportunity to improve outputs from our program, and early indications are showing that it's paying dividends. The second part was that then, you know, it gave us an opportunity to integrate our program into the broader Department of Health activities. And so CQI became that vehicle that said, you know, when we went to the Department of Health to ask for support, it was always difficult. But when we went to CQI to say, can we work together to improve service delivery, then there was some kind of buy-in from their side. And so in addition to that, it also kind of enabled us to create some internal systems for having some checks and balances into what are we doing, are we doing the right thing, because my sites are in very remote areas and sometimes it's easy to be far removed from the main program. So that gave us an opportunity to see how we are doing and compare ourselves to others. So that was mainly the motivation from our side.
Thank you very much to John, Cephas, and Shepard. I am afraid that for now, that is the time that we have for questions. However, at the end of the webinar, we will come back to some additional questions that we have to try to give the opportunity to our panelists to address them. We will also make sure after the webinar that all questions posted on the chat or emailed to us will be answered by our colleagues. ASIS will post the responses and send out a link to all participants. Now we are going to change format. And I would like to invite my colleague Lani Marquez from ASIS to take us into our first panel. This first panel is comprised of ASIS staff in South Africa, Uganda, Malawi, in Tanzania, for them to give us their perspective on how to get started on CQI on VMMC.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. I'm very happy to have Tewange Moyo, our resident advisor in Malawi, Davis Rumisha, our chief of party in Tanzania, Donna Jacobs, our regional director for Southern Africa and chief of party in South Africa, and John Biabagambi. So, Davis, I'd like to start with you. You just got started in April with engaging stakeholders in CQI and just began your first baseline assessments. Can you tell us what's worked well in Tanzania in terms of getting the baseline assessment started?
Good morning, Lani, and the rest of the participants. This is Davis from Tanzania. Yes, we started in April. And I think we started when the program had already, the BMMC program started 5 years down the line. So we joined an ongoing program. And that program at that time, they had already circumcised 1.2 million people. And they seemed to have, they were actually meant to meet the national target of 2.5 million people at the end of the target year. The problem of us coming in the middle of the program was that since the program was doing well and they were circumcising, and it was not quite clear whether they are doing it right, but the numbers were actually adding up. The entry point was quite challenging. And what we did was to really look from our neighbors, Uganda, who had already started the program a little bit earlier. We went to Uganda and we sort of learned how they started, and we picked up some tools that they were used, and came home to start to tailor them to our needs. Those tools actually proved to be quite useful for us. First of all, they extended the carrot to the other partners, because I think we came at the time when the ministry was also coming up with the national guidelines, and we came in to assist the ministry to finalize the guidelines, and they also sort of called out the other groups to combine efforts to really look at the tools. We decided to divide roles among the partners and the ministry so that everybody knows what we're supposed to do. We sort of saw that the quality improvement, CQI, as a way of actually getting better services. And we sort of appointed the Uganda program or the Achievements Uganda as a carrot for the rest of the people. So it actually gave us an entry point, and we then was accepted. And we started getting the tools right and getting the people right. And of course, we thereafter went to the field to start testing the tools and obviously making up a plan for assessment for the whole, 12 regions. And we have only managed to assess only 6. It was a learning program for us, because I think also we found that even to do it, we need to really get the right people, the right entry points, and of course the right approach to continue. We have started, and we are going to continue starting the program. Our starting late, of course, was also an opportunity, because we found that when the VMMC program started in Tanzania, it could have been the right time to start with the CQI program. Because I think we learned that it's actually a program that can improve achieving numbers faster and achieving them at a cost-effective and user-friendly way. As we go along, we find that some of the regions or some of the areas that we are going to assess, they have already reached the saturation level. So we pick up looking at how can we sustain the program. Now that we have the government behind us and all the partners with us, we will be able to set up a sustainable or sustainability program, particularly in those areas which have reached saturation now. The major thing then we learn is that we need to carry everybody with us. It's better to start CQI as we start the program. And I think we need to learn from others rather than reinvent the wheel. Thank you very much, Lani.
Thank you, Davis. And we'll be sending people to learn from Tanzania next.
Oh, thank you. Until we are through.
Tewake, I'm going to see if we can reach you now. We look like we're still having trouble with audio, but can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, Lani. Good morning.
Again, I'd like to ask you, I know you've gotten off to a very fast start in Malawi. So what advice do you have for other countries for getting off to such a fast start?
Okay, thank you. One of the things that really worked very well in Malawi was early involvement of all the relevant stakeholders at various levels. We involved various stakeholders at national level. This included the Department of HIV and AIDS and the Department of Nursing, which is responsible for all the quality assurance activities within the Ministry of Health. So we made various presentations to these departments, and then the Ministry of Health introduced us at the National Technical Working Group responsible for VMMC. At this technical working group, we made a presentation on what ASIS has been doing since 2012 in Malawi, how we've been using the CQI approach to improve services, social services, and the nutrition services within the Ministry of Health. So after we presented the results of what we've seen in other projects, and we also presented a roadmap to the implementing partners at national level, just to give an indication of what we had planned in our work plan and how we are going to get there. So after we made the presentations and on the roadmap, all the partners were able to see what were the activities that were lined up in terms of CQI for Malawi. And we also had a privilege to participate in the USAID external quality assessment that was done in February. And this really paved way for the for implementing partners to appreciate the gaps, the quality gaps that existed within their sites, the VMMC sites. So when the EQA was done, the partners were really appreciative and they were waiting for the CQI. CQI came at a very opportune time to, as a mechanism to address, to help address those quality and safety gaps that were in their sites. So one of the things which we've learned and which I would recommend for other countries that is just starting this work is the early involvement of all relevant stakeholders at national, district, and zonal health offices to just to ensure that everybody, when you are starting, you are on the same page and they know exactly what is supposed to happen and who is supposed to do what and what ASIS role is going to be. Basically, is to complement the services the implementing partners are already doing. And I would also recommend that involvement of the implementing partners in the baseline assessment is key because as for Malawi, we thought at the beginning when we were starting the organizing and preparing ourselves for the baseline assessment, we thought that including the implementing partner staff as part of the assessors to collect this baseline information would really compromise maybe the results because we thought that they might be biased to assess themselves. But we've learned that including them in the to be part of the assessment team really has helped them to understand what the scores mean, especially when they are scoring less than 50. What a 20%, a 0% means, so they are able to appreciate to say to understand to say they got how they got that score. And at first, when we had not involved them, we felt that there was more kind of resistance from them. But when we involved them, they were part of the assessment team. They were able to appreciate the challenges that existed in terms of quality and what the gaps were, and they were more receptive of the results that the results of the sites that were assessed. So really, the involvement of these implementing partners in the collecting of the baseline assessment is very crucial. Thank you.
Thank you, Tuwange. Those are great points. I'd like to turn now to my colleague, Donna Jacobs. So what is notable from the mention that Don did in his presentation is that in South Africa, the CQI activity started at very large scale, very quickly. So I'd like you to tell us a little bit about some of the challenges of starting at that scale, but also the opportunities.
Thank you very much, Lani. In South Africa, we started at very large scale looking at doing baseline assessments at about 127 sites. One of the strengths of this was that we looked at both USAID-funded as well as CDC-funded partners, and that gave us an opportunity to assess and compare both models. We also found differences, but we found a lot of similarities. We were able to look at mobile sites, outreach sites, fixed sites, and private sites like Dr. Mapita's, which provided us with an opportunity to learn across the different public, private, fixed, and mobile sites and transfer some of the good practices that were happening across all of the sites. We were also able to comment on the strengths and areas for improvement for all the partners. One of the big challenges with starting off at such a great scale was coordination. I must say that you need really, really good coordination to be able to do a baseline assessment at 127 sites involving 9 different partners and 2 funding agencies in the space of 3 months. So I must say that my administrative and logistics team did a fantastic job in addition to our assessors. We also were doing the baseline assessment during the winter peak period, which was not particularly ideal since people were very busy. However, when we conducted the assessment and presented the findings, no one was very happy, which was another big challenge because, of course, you know, people felt that CQI had come into their facilities and found everything that was going wrong. But I must say that at the same time, there was an EQA process ongoing, which found many of the same findings that we did, which then helped to reinforce some of the findings from CQI. And I must say that for us, the really important point of doing the CQI baseline was not to find out what was wrong, but to look at areas for improvement. And as we have seen during this webinar, the partners that have engaged with some of the gaps in their service delivery have really gone from strength to strength, and we're seeing massive improvements within the sites, as well as within the partner staff themselves, who are very motivated and have bought into the CQI process itself.
Okay, great. So I think what we'll do now in the interest of time is we're gonna move on to our second panel.
Thank you. thank you to ASIS colleagues. I really want to stress the best practices that our colleagues from ASIS spoke about, making good use of existing tools, early and frequent stakeholder engagement, orienting all stakeholders to what CQI is, and using EQA results to motivate attention to CQI, ongoing communication across partners, and I think we can go on and go on, but we have several case studies that were developed by ASIS that I posted on the website that can actually help all of you guys to be able to learn from what ASIS have already done and being able to get started CQI in your programs. Now, let's move to another panel, a panel of stakeholders who are extremely important for this activity. Their leadership really is the key for this activity to get started. And I would like to invite Donna Jacob to introduce our second panel and ask some questions to our panelists.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. Colleagues, it gives me great pleasure to introduce our second panel, made up of people who have walked the walk in improving MMC programming and who each brings a distinct perspective to share their advice on supporting CQI initiatives. For our stakeholder panel, our speakers are Ms. Jacqueline Kalman, who is the technical advisor with USAID Uganda, who is actually the lead for quality improvement in HIV services for USAID. Mr. Simeon Legenji, whom we heard from earlier, who is the National MMC Coordinator, and we will take his comments into consideration when we discuss this panel. Dr. Alfred Berry, who is a public health specialist with CDC in South Africa and is currently the biomedical lead at CDC. And Sister Pauline Biola, the Quality Assurance Unit Manager for CHAPS in South Africa. Jackie, if I may start with you, may I ask what you have seen from the USAID perspective in Uganda about the value of adding the CQI program to the VMMC work that USAID has invested in Uganda? Jackie, go ahead.
Hello, can you hear?
Yes, Jackie, go ahead.
Okay. All right. So the value of CQI, we've seen it at two different levels, both at the national level as well as the site and district level. I'll start by the value of CQI at the national level. We've seen at least, I can mention about 4 points. One was we with the integration of CQI, we revised the national policies and guidelines consistent with the current updated WHO guidelines. We also collectively defined national standards for VMMC services, and this wasn't the case in the past. We had kind of outdated standards that were not broad enough, as well as we standardized training curriculum, whereby we integrated CQI as part of the curriculum, but prior to that we had different partners having different kinds of curriculum. Finally, at the national level, it enhanced partnership between MOH and different IPs. So due to the need for collaboration and coordination with the CQI that we needed, we found that we needed to enhance this. The coordination led to improved partnership between the ministry and the partners. So at the service delivery points and district level, where the CQI, the value of CQI, we saw that there was a shift from a focus on numbers to the quality of care of VMMC services, such as the patient follow-up, pre- and post-op care. Secondly, we also saw that the CQI catalyzed system and process improvement in other areas, for instance, the surgical theater, waste management, and particularly data quality, given that CQI is heavily reliant on data. And lastly, at the site level, we've also identified efficient and effective implementation models that have contributed to the achievement of the targets that we've had. So for instance, in Uganda, we, following the CQI, we actually saw this a significant improvement in targets from about 352,000 in achieved in 2012 to 742,000 achieved in 2013. And we attribute this significant improvement partly to the CQI. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Jackie. That is just so invaluable. And I think it echoes exactly what we saw during CFIS's presentation, where an improvement in quality also looks at a corresponding improvement in the actual numbers of the conclusions achieved. Thank you so much. I would like to now bring in CDC's perspective as well. So let me turn to Dr. Alfred Berry of CDC South Africa. Alfred, we would like to hear the CDC's perspective on how CQI has worked for CDC-supported sites in South Africa. Please let me know, what do you see as the value added of the CQI program, and what advice would you give to your colleagues in other countries who are embarking on this? Go ahead, Alfred.
Thank you, Donna, for the introduction. Can you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead.
All right. Thank you. So to address your questions, I would like to first emphasize that for CQI to work, there has to be an understanding of what we're trying to achieve. And from what the previous speakers has alluded to, I think we're all in agreement that there has to be some form of involvement of the right people, which I totally agree with. But I would like to also add that in order for us to identify these gaps and in order for us to address these, not only do we need to work with top management, but we also need to have buy-in at facility level. So speaking from a funder's perspective, I realize that we spend most of our time really talking to the top management, which I've seen that they understand what's going on. But as long as you're not going to have this information drilled down to the people who are actually doing the work, you run into problems. And from the previous site visits that I've done, you realize that when you speak to the cadre that is on the ground, you realize that some of them aren't really aware of the day-to-day quality improvements that they need to do at their own facilities. So it is very important that, you know, for CQI to work, it has to be understood by the people that are doing the job. But I would like to say, once you have that buy-in, it is, you know, the joy that you see in the teams when they see those, you know, when they look at the dashboards and they see the red turning into green, it's very rewarding. So So it's very important that we have that buy-in. So in terms of the value added, so once you have the different stakeholders involved, not only are you going to end up with improved services, but also you increase, you build ownership, you build the trust. And I think I would like to, from CDC side, I would like to really thank Donna and the team for being resilient. And like what you've mentioned, you know, the landscape in South Africa is quite different from other countries. You have two funders, you have nine different partners using different models. So it's really important that, you know, you have buy-in from all the different stakeholders. So I would like to say, in terms of the value added, the quality of service that you provide speaks to the number of people who come seeking for that service. So not only when you address quality, to some extent indirectly, you address the number of people who are going to come seeking that same service, because a happy client is bound to tell somebody that they're also happy with the kind of service that they've received. In terms of advice that I'll give to other countries, I would say for CQI to work, I think for partners, they have to be able to receive negative feedback. So if you don't receive negative feedback well, you'll be very resilient, and you see a CQI team as somebody who's either trying to audit you. So at the end of the day, we need to understand the reasons why we're doing CQI so that we don't end any resistance coming from the partners. And I think given the benefits of VMMC, this is something we should be committed to provide safely, and it should be of high quality. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alfred, for those fantastic answers. I think the follow-up question that I have for you is really from the CDC perspective, how have you tried to encourage your implementing partners to take that focus on CQI? And what have you seen to really work that engages the facility level providers?
Okay, so thank you, Donna, for the question. Like I've said before, when URC came into the game, what happened is the CDC partners saw this as a USAID initiative. So it's really hard, and this is based on the conversations and the emails. So it's really hard for our partners to just accept it as it is. But over time and after, you know, various communications and just, you know, emphasizing to the partners that this is not a USAID initiative. This is a PEPFA initiative, and it should be included in our framework. It has improved in terms of how partners accept this. So I guess it's very important on the messaging that goes out. And how we've tried to do it from CDC side is, if Donna wants to reach out to our partners, we'll also follow up to show that we are in this together. So at the end of the day, the partners will accept more to just see that it's not just coming from one agency. This is a collective effort. And we, at the end of the day, we need to work as one.
Thank you so much, Alfred. And I think I should also add, having been integrally involved in this process, that Alfred's leadership has been instrumental. When we as Assist met with the CDC partners for the first time, it was actually Alfred who was chairing the meeting, and he made it very clear to all the CDC partners that CQI was something that all CDC partners had to engage with, as CDC took this very seriously. So I believe that really CDC has leadership from the top, and for that, Alfred, I'd like to say thank you very much. And I would also like to say that for every agency looking at CQI, this is very important. This is a PEPFA initiative. And honestly, at the end of the day, it benefits all the clients that we are so desperately trying to help. So thank you so much, Alfred and Jackie. Let me now turn to our final panelist, Sister Pauline Biola from CHAPS in South Africa. Sister Biola, CHAPS has a unique role as both an implementing partner and a technical support partner in South Africa. May I ask, what advice would you give to implementing partners in other countries who are going to start CQI? And what have you learned in doing this work that really helps CQI to get going?
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Biola.
First of all, Donna, thank you so much for the question, and thank you for the opportunity that you guys have gave me to be part of this webinar. So thank you. So first of all, my advice to other partner will be to take quality assurance as well as CQI in to take it seriously, because it's a very important factor that we need to take into consideration when we're doing MC or running MC program. And because it goes along and it goes together, so it's not something that you have to separate in order to improve your services. And secondly, I would like also to advise other partner as well to really welcome or embrace the work that URC is providing to in terms of improving quality around services and sustain the CQI for quite long term, because as being part of CHAPS and as a quality assurance manager, we did really take URC advice into very big consideration, and for us, we look at it as a guide to us in order to improve what was not going well into our site. And as you know, CHAPS have a lot of sites, close to 71 within South Africa, so it's a big responsibility that we did undertake already. And URC has been playing a big role to that. At the point now, I know all the URC team in different area. So I would like to encourage all partner and other stakeholders to really take advice from URC, to consider URC as their mentor and also as their guide to do great job, because this is what we did and it happened to work for us so far, and we are happy about that. And thirdly, the partner, in order to start a very great CQI when the running MC program, they need to have a well-dedicated team and willing to learn and understand firstly the concept around quality assurance and CQI, because you can only work with that if you understand what it's all about, if you have any idea of what they're expecting from you. So the training about CQI is very important for them to implement it in a way that it becomes sustainable.
Thank you so much, Biola. I think that's fantastic. I must say that CHAPS is doing a great job in terms of quality assurance, and we really are looking to work together with you and the rest of the team to ensure that the sites benefit from all of the interventions.
Thank you, Bill.
So, with that, I would like to thank my panelists for doing a phenomenal job on this panel. Thank you, Jackie, Alfred, and Biola. And let me hand over now back to Emmanuel.
Thank you, Donna and colleagues. You really gave us food for thought on practical ways to support this work. Jackie's emphasis on standardization of tools and broad-based stakeholder engagement, Simeon's advice on having a strong technical working group at the helm led by the ministry, Alfred's suggestion that engaging site-level providers in CQI is really key to make quality better, and Biola's use of Idanon's visit to make sure that quality improvement is not just seen as what is done the day after an assessment, but rather influencing what providers do when assessors are not there, are important best practices that other countries can apply. Before we wrap up this webinar, I would like to highlight where you can find some resources for CQI. John has already mentioned the article that soon will be coming out in PLOS One about the initial CQI work in 30 pilot sites in Uganda. Tools and case studies coming out of the work in Uganda are available now on the ASIS website. I have also asked ASIS to develop a generic VMMC CQI guide, which will be finalized and field tested in the coming months, with a generic baseline assessment tool that can be adapted in each country and an Excel tool to generate the dashboard. This webinar is a testimony on how important quality and safety are to PEPFAR. As I said at the start, CQI is not an optional strategy. We are convinced that all VMMC programs must incorporate CQI in how they operate. Quality and safety are not optional. I hope that everyone who participated in today's webinar have new ideas about how CQI can help your program. Before we end, I would like to acknowledge the hard work of all the implementing partners in these four countries. Today we have heard from ASIS and additional colleagues, but really CQI is about ownership, is about what the providers are doing on the site, is about those partner staff who are supporting those sites. The leadership of the Ministries of Health, all U.S. government agencies, the Pharmacy Concerned Technical Working Group, and ASIS for all the work done since 2012 to pilot and scale up VMMC CQI and now sharing of lessons learned. Our hope is that implementing partners can then build on this lesson learned to incorporate CQI into their programming and can then be able to apply one of the key advice we receive from our colleague in Tanzania, which is when you start a site, think about CQI from the beginning. Don't wait when the site is in operation after several years to be able to introduce CQI. Now, I would like to remind all of us that we look forward to your participation in an equally stimulating VMMC webinar on Thursday, hosted by the John Hopkins Center for Communication Program. The July 9 webinar will feature a series of speakers discussing how we can sustain the gain in HIV prevention by integrating VMMC into routine newborn and adolescent care when a country or a geographical area has reached high coverage for adult and adolescent and now move from the catch-up to sustainability for this program. Finally, I want to say thank you very much to all the technical staff of ASIS for the support and logistics support for this webinar. Thank you very much to Lani, Donna, and ASIS for all the technical support to make this session possible and being able to put together all this information that today we were able to share with all the implementing partners. The recording of the webinar will be posted on the website. All the questions that we were not able to answer during this session will also be answered by ASIS technical colleagues, and those answers will be posted also on the website. So please, if you have additional questions, continue to send them, and I'm sure that Lani, Donna, John, and Chiwonge will be more than happy to provide a detailed answer to those questions. They also told me that they are fully available to help you and your organization to be able to take on this work and add this in your operations as you guys support VMMC site in various countries. Thank you very much. And I close this session.
Very good. Thank you so much,
Emmanuel. Thank you so much to all of our participants. It has been a pleasure to spend these 2 hours with you. just for you to know that we've had over 80 participants logged on during the webinar. So thank you all very much for your engagement.
Great. And as Emmanuel said, we will be taking all of the questions posted on chat, and there were some excellent ones that we weren't able to deal with, and we will be posting responses from our panelists on the ASSIST website. So with that, thank you very much for your participation, and we look forward to seeing you at the VMMC and Sustainability webinar on Thursday. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now.
Thank you, Ronnie.
Thank you very much, David. Thank you all.
Thank you, everybody, for attending.